Denniston. I started work up there in 1949.
Well, I think Dad took me up there to scare the shit out of me so I wouldn't want to go and work there.
All the mining was over the back, all underground mining, back in 79.
That's what the West Coast is built on. That's what our forefathers came here for.
Quite typical weather-wise. Noticing how quickly the fog's billowing up the hill here. Quite an eerie, ghostly feeling. Seeing all the skeletons over there. And here we are. There's a coal-bearing plateau all the way down the west coast of the South Island, from Buller down to Strongman.
Westland is a very interesting area in New Zealand in terms of biodiversity, and it's probably one of the most biodiverse, one of the richest places in New Zealand for a variety of natural history, plants and animals.
The deal that's typically been done for the West Coast is that in return for jobs for West Coast people, the profit all goes somewhere else, and we take the environmental damage and we take the risk that goes with coal mining activity. And that's not a deal that actually can really be sustained on into the future.
Governments talk about proactivity and about economic sustainability, neither of which seem to be a priority on the West Coast. They seem to be stripping it for everything they've got without a view to the future.
There's no doubt that the climate is warming. Nobody's contesting that. And the forecasts or the projections for the future are an escalating mean annual temperature.
5 years ago, I decided I needed to write a book. And this book, The Cliff and the Fog, was published in 2009.
We don't have a planet B. We have one planet. And we are really conducting an experiment on planet Earth. We don't know all of the facts. We know enough that there is serious risk for the survival of humanity. And that is why we need to take a cautionary approach and say that we cannot continue with this experiment of ever-increasing amounts of greenhouse gases being introduced into the atmosphere.
Not many kids actually really understand what it's going to mean, or we tend to gloss over it because we don't really want to face up to those things for our future generations.
The question, whose country is it, is not easy to answer and it's quite important. Is it mine? Is it my kids? Is it nobody's? Is it the future's? Or what?
If you draw down coal, in theory, you should create a piece of infrastructure which produces enough energy over time to replace the value you've received from that coal. And as a civilization, as a society, we don't. But if you're in a business like that, you're out of business very, very quickly. And obviously, if we keep utilising coal for rather wasteful purposes, as is a civilisation, we won't exist.
Well, old misty mountain, old mountain of time, making a living way down that old mine. 6 in the morning till next icy light. God willing, I'm home for supper tonight. Many a story's been told in the past. of men being victim to fall and to blast. But when the smoke clears, the dust settles down. Lads, pick up your shovels back underground.
I didn't like school. And I went to work up in the coal mine on the survey to start with, then coal mine later on. I never regretted it either. I used to love the work. I loved hard work, and I got pretty fit at doing the hard work too. So it was a good thing for me.
'Cause I've filled the boxes and I've clipped the chains, and I've called the shots, whistled the trains. Just picking a life by putting it down. That old dark and dusty hole in the ground.
Just like working in a creek. The water was gushing down. You'd fire a heap of shots, big heap of coal, and you put it down into the water and it would barricade. All the water would be going behind it, and then as you shoveled the coal away, the water would start coming through, and then in the finish it would come through and wash everything out of the way. And this boss came along this day, he said, "Look," he said, "you guys are making a mess of this," he said, "just let it go quietly." So he got a shovel and he went down and let it go quietly. He let it go quietly. He got no show at all. It just bloody ripped out. The bloody timber was going all sorts. He said, "You see what I mean?" He said, "Yes, Benny, we can see what you mean."
I was only 12, I think, at that time. I remember going into the bathhouse and they're all having me on, of course. This big long line of naked bodies showering. I was too scared to strip and have a shower. I was far too modest at that age. And I went home dirty in the bus and got more ribbing for it than I would have otherwise.
I think that that's incredibly powerful in Westport, that Denniston is, it's iconic, I think. It's iconic nationally, but locally it is a very important part of the local psyche.
This is where I used to live, over here. And here is the Mount Rochford Hotel, which was next door. And the old picture hall, and the bus garage, and the butchery where my father worked.
Oh, yeah, well, I was the boss of the union for a few years. I took over in 1976, I think it was, when I took over. I didn't like the way it was being managed at the time. One of the guys was just a bloody alcoholic. So I stood against him and had no trouble at all taking over. I used to try and get everybody, let everybody a fair go, you know. But there were some bloody hard shots in that bloody outfit. We wouldn't go to work if the bathhouse wasn't up to a certain degree. We'd just tell them we're not going to work because that bloody temperature's not up. And they'd be flat out trying to get it right.
Dad was only two. They came out in 1913. That was just at the end of the first waterside strike, 1913. And his father-in-law was already here. He lost his life shortly after in the knock-a-war bins. He went up to free a hang-up. He was loading wagons. And those days they put a ladder down into the bin. And the ladder must have got carried away and he fell and got smothered before they could find him.
Listen at night when the wind starts to call, and I hear the voice of those that did fall. they're singing a song as a boy I did learn. The mountain is waiting, we all have our turn. 'Cause I've filled the boxes and I've clipped the chains, and I've called the shots, whistled the trains. Just picking a life by putting it down. That old dark and dusty hole in the ground. That old dark and dusty hole in the ground.
About 1980, way back in the past, all the different areas of New Zealand were surveyed for their ecological values. And on the West Coast, the surveyors decreed that the most interesting place of the lot, the best ecological areas, were on the Denniston Plateau. And at that stage, 20, 30 years ago now, the ecologists and the scientists that prepared the reports recommended that four areas on the Denniston Plateau be set aside as special ecological areas. Fast forward to today, we have a mining operation, a very small mining operation from Western Australia has come to New Zealand, and they've decided they'd really like to mine the Denniston Plateau. Guess what? Three of the areas they want to mine, for which they've already purchased mining licenses, which were already in existence and have been in existence for a long time, pick off three of those ecological areas. All the land on the Denniston Plateau is conservation land, and they want to mine. They want access across conservation land. They want to mine these three areas. Furthermore, they have big plans. They want to put a coal processing plant up there, and they want to expand mining. So this is the thin end of the wedge. So we've got the most interesting area on the west coast of New Zealand, 50% of which has already gone to mining, and now they want the lot.
A lot of people are asking, how come you could have a mine like this on conservation land, and conservation land that's been identified as high priority for biodiversity? I mean, isn't that a nonsense? But in fact, the only land in New Zealand that is legally protected from mining is the land listed under Schedule 4 of the Crown Minerals Act. And I was in Parliament when that schedule was passed, and it gave protection to national parks and a few other categories of very important conservation land, but it's only a minority of the total conservation land in the country, and there are some very, very important ecological areas that are not part of it. Schedule 4 is what the government tried to get rid of, and there was a huge public outcry, and they changed their minds. But they changed their minds because they knew there was only about 13% of the conservation land that that protected anyway. The rest of the conservation land is still up for grabs.
Well, this must have been it. I'm sure if I went down there, I'd find the steps or the chimney or something. It only takes a generation, and that's all that there is of a family.
I guess the first concern is that my children live in a country that is a democracy, where they're not controlled by people who cannot be brought to account. That's the first thing. And democracies fail when people don't get involved, and when the few who look for power manipulate the majority so much that the majority is stupid and accept what's being done for them.
New Zealand law doesn't distinguish between New Zealand companies and overseas companies. They all have the same rights. The first thing they need if they want to mine coal is a mining permit from the Ministry of Economic Development. That's really, really easy to get, and there's no public process at all. But before they can mine, they need consent under the Resource Management Act. So they need to apply both to the local district council, the Buller District Council in this case, and to the regional council, the West Coast Regional Council, for a whole series of consents about water discharges and land use and moving of vegetation, a whole lot of different consents, historic heritage, the lot. But that's only step one. Next it goes to the Environment Court. There's a widespread view that you can't deal with climate change at all under the Resource Management Act. That view is being challenged with legal submissions at the Environment Court, and we'll see where that argument gets to. It could potentially go all the way up the court system to the Supreme Court.
Forever free.
as stars did light. Lights from another time now reflect off the sea. Echoes of yesterday, wild south, forever free, forever free. We just want to do what we've done in the past better than we've done in the past, and just give our people employment.
There's probably full employment on the West Coast at the moment. I can't see any benefit to local communities by increasing the rate of coal mining, because we're just bringing in workers, we're bringing in capital, we're bringing in expertise. Those people won't be there, they'll go.
Lots of people have said we have to change what we do, but what can we do other than make a living off our earth and environment?
Just initiatives that will create employment outside the mine industry. And if something's done about it now, we've got 20-year head start to be able to be breaking free on a nice and easy level, rather than an absolute stop and ghost town syndrome, which will happen. It's happened before.
West Coast coal community should actually, I believe, be lobbying intensively, and local body politicians should be lobbying intensively for an increase in royalties on that coal extraction. That will slow down the rate of extraction and mean that their economies based on coal will last for longer, and also lobby intensively to the recycling of those revenues into the community, not just being used by government to balance their expenditure. Recycling the communities for capital expenditure on other business models.
At the moment, government isn't interested in helping any transition out of coal mining because it's fostering coal mining with everything that it can do. Government policy is very strongly anything, any fossil fuel, anywhere in New Zealand or its offshore waters that can be dug up and sold should be dug up and sold. That is policy. So they're obviously not interested in even talking about how you transition out of that. But what is actually really unfair to the people of the coast is to present coal mining as an opportunity for young people going into a new career. Because if in fact we are going to phase out coal over 20 years, which James Hansen, a leading climate scientist, says is going to be necessary to have any chance at all of returning to a stable climate, then the people who are coal mining now and the mines that are already open and functioning can continue to run until the coal is depleted and the miners retire. So no one actually needs to lose their job in the mines if you have a policy of phasing out coal. But if you don't have that policy and you open a whole lot of new mines and you get a whole lot of young people trained up and into mining, they are the ones that are going to suffer when the crunch has to come and the mining has to stop. So we're not doing them any service at all by encouraging them to get into mining now at 18 or whatever they are.
I don't know, I'm from the West Coast, so it's kind of a coal mining industry down there, but personally, I quite like our environment, and New Zealand's got quite a, you know, clean green image, and I think, you know, the more coal mining and stuff we do, probably our image is going to get destroyed.
Do you think New Zealand should mine more coal?
No.
Why not?
I don't know. I'm not sure what's really involved, but it's just so the destruction that occurs when, you know, a mine is kind of put in place in this country. Yeah, it's not good.
Environmental destruction.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, this country is known for its beauty and natural environment, and we go ahead and destroy that, we're kind of cutting our foot off at the same time. And yeah, it's a treasure, this country, so we have to look after it.
If you're going to dig up all our forests and stuff, then no. But if they can get it out without pollution, go for it. Make the money.
Yeah.
Is that a good enough
answer?
What
about when you burn it?
It can be burned cleanly, but that takes effort, and most countries aren't willing to put the effort in. So, but if it can be burned cleanly, go for it.
No, I don't think so.
Nah.
Why not?
Because it's our country, and we should be looking after it.
I'd like to see it blocked and that. I think, you know, like keeping New Zealand and all those places like that, like keep it, you know, New Zealand.
New Zealand's biggest environmental challenge is actually the loss of unique species. When I attend international conferences and you line New Zealand up and you look at our air quality and you look at our water quality, you look at our proportion of renewable energy, we actually stack up pretty good. You know, the level of chemical contamination and poisoning and all those things is, we're not 100%, but we're pretty close and we're pretty good. The area, though, in which we've got a huge challenge is that we have thousands and thousands of species that exist only in New Zealand. And part of our difficulty of our British ancestry is in the whole of Britain, there is one endemic species. Only one species exists only in Britain and nowhere else in the world. In New Zealand, it's tens of thousands, and so we are a treasure box.
It's the incongruousness of giving mining precedence over any other environmental rights or statutes that the unique plants and animals that we have in New Zealand have. They should have rights too, in the same way that people have rights.
I draw attention to a speech that John Key gave in 2010, at the opening of Parliament in 2010. When he mentioned the environment in a section of his speech titled Unlocking Resources.
I haven't been able to think of anything we do that's not dependent on mining, whether it's the fillings in your teeth, the rims on your spectacles, the paper, books, the printing presses, the transport, whatever you do, the roads, there's mining is at the bottom of it, whether it's mining oil or rocks or metals or whatever. So there's a problem there. If you don't like mining, the only option is to go back to a subsistence nomadic culture, because you don't even have a spade to dig your veggies. Hmm.
People say, well, the world couldn't survive without mining. But I would make a strong distinction between mining for metals and mining for coal. Coal you mine in order to burn it, and it's coal that is warming the atmosphere and the planet and leading to horrendous climate change with metres of sea level rise and droughts and floods and storms that our grandchildren are going to have great difficulty coping with. You know, we are leaving them a world that will be much worse to live in than the world that we have lived in. Mining for other materials, like you might look at some of the rare metals that go into electronics and things like that, they're not necessarily environmentally friendly, but if you do them very carefully, you can do them without changing the climate, and some mining will continue. But you can't mine coal environmentally responsibly. There's absolutely no way of doing it. Once you get that coal out of the ground, it doesn't matter what you do with it, the carbon will end up in the atmosphere and it will end up changing climate.
Well, I gather a lot of the argument now is swinging around to the cause of global warming, and it's believed that coal's the instigator of that. It's yet to be proved to me that it is the cause of global warming.
If anyone is open-minded enough to pay attention to the evidence available in the publicly available peer-reviewed scientific literature, anyone can check that out if they are curious enough. You'll find that the vast majority, overwhelmingly in number, in the climate science community, are coming to the same conclusions. And the science community are a relatively conservative bunch of people. They don't like waving their arms around and getting too excited and saying, hey, we should be doing this or we should be doing that. Scientists tend to just step back and say, look, this is the information. You interpret it as you wish. Our job is to be policy relevant, but not to be policy prescriptive, not to tell people what to do. but in spite of that, many in the science community are starting to stand up and say, actually, we need to act on this. It's more than just a dispassionate scientific story, because there's real livelihoods and real communities and real suffering at stake here.
Are you worried about global warming?
Yeah.
How worried?
Well, it's something that we should definitely be all concerned about and do our best to try and prevent it. Yeah.
I guess it's going to affect our futures for sure and our children's futures. But the fact is the fact that it's not going to affect ours. It can be kind of selfish, but at the same time, but yeah, I'm not too.
Very worried. I think it's the wrong thing to do. It's not the right way forward, certainly, especially when we have so many other technologies that we could use instead of coal.
Who are you worried for?
Oh, for everyone, for our future children, but for all New Zealanders that don't have a chance to say no. I wish that people would listen to what the general public want in this case.
Do you think we should expand the coal mines?
No, not at all. I think more important aspects, tourism, New Zealand's clean green image, probably more important than short-term benefits of selling off the coal.
It depends what kind of an impact that would have on the environment and what kind of input it would be towards the economy. Like you kind of want to set the scales properly so it has like an equalizing effect, I guess. So,
thank you.
Yeah.
What do you think about it?
I have no idea.
I don't know much about coal mines, but probably not.
Why not?
Because I think that the energy sort of production should move away from coal into sort of more renewable sort of things. So I don't think mining more coal is going to resolve anything. It's just going to prolong the issue.
I think that it's a dangerous thing to do.
What they're doing is drawing down capital assets to fund their expenditure. Any business, any nation that does that is doomed to fail. That's just poor business. That's just, it's mindless stupidity. Unfortunately, that's how all governments around the world behave. That's how we treat all natural resources, but they are capital assets. You can't draw them down to fund your expenditure. That's just basic business accounting. If we draw them down, we need to get something better than that. We shouldn't be using it to balance our books.
Until you arrive in the sea of humanity, like on the tube train in Tokyo or the street in Mexico City, you don't quite get the feel of this overcrowdedness that is increasing and increasing exponentially. The street in China, it's fantastic. It's fantastic. Flying into Los Angeles at night, you look out of the window and there's streetlights and cars, ribbons of cars, 3-litre engines, as far as you can see in all directions. It's fantastic what the human being is doing on this planet. Yeah, I think we are a toxic plague, like locusts. And I'm just one of them. There's 7 billion of us as of last week. Yeah. How do we slow it? Or do we just hit, you know, a cliff that we can't see yet?
Governments will only act if there is overwhelming pressure from the people for them to act. And you've got to remember that there is already overwhelming pressure from the corporate interests. They're constantly in the government's ear. Many of them fund political parties. They're forever lobbying, and they're very skilled lobbyists. The people have got to make a big enough noise to counter that, and that's quite hard to do because they're not funded and they're not as organised. But that's the task ahead of us, actually. Only when New Zealand citizens rise up in very large numbers and say, leave the Denniston Plateau alone, stop opening new coal mines, do something serious about climate change. Only when that becomes overwhelming and the government knows it's going to be voted out next election if it doesn't do it, will they actually do anything.
In my soul, there's a fire burning cold. Keep me warm through pain and sorrow. And though some may say, gone is the day, will they get what they hope for? For this is my town, and this is my life. Here are the grounds that we played on, and a river of tears flows back through the years. The faces I knew, some no longer.
Mum's work in the day shift, washing sheets, fires the old copper, quietly weeps. Questions to mind that would never cross his. Who shovels most coal? Who brings up our kids? 6 of them porridged and banished to school. Oh dear, are they warm? It's yet a bit cool. Stripped all the beds for Monday's big wash. Her mind's in a turmoil, emotions awash. Him on the coal, bound to knock off wet time. She's wringing her hands and pegging the line. He'll be out of the pit about 3:45. then off to the pub, just a bit of a drive. It's round about then the kids jostle in. Her back shift starts with their hungry din. Doles out a snack with the odd little smack, sighs with despair as the coal range blows back. The meal will appear, seeming out of thin air. Kids are all fed, picks at her share. He's late, with a skinful, recounting the day. Reads his paper, boys now scrapping, girls squealing their rage. He bellows and curses, drives her to the brink. Derides him, he says, drives him to drink. Wins never the war, an odd skirmish instead. Then shares a laid bed, tries to rest her tired head. Questions again as she's starting to drift, and the clock counts down to her next double shift.
The only way you can make steel is through the use of coal. And so the question you have to ask as part of a global economy is, if New Zealand says, well, we're going to take a very pure position, we're not going to dig any more coal out of the ground, do we really think that will result in any less steel being produced in the world, where New Zealand's coal production is less than 0.1% of global coal production? And is really New Zealand being honest when it's going to carry on using steel in its cars and its other areas and simply importing that steel, in many cases from less efficient steel mills or from lesser quality coals from around the world? And that is why, when you're looking at those issues with solid energy and New Zealand's coal resources, you need to take a global perspective. You know, the old environmental saying, think globally, act locally, is true. And for us to simply do things locally that make us feel good, but actually do not contribute positively globally, in my view, is unsound, and that's why the government doesn't adopt that approach.
The time that people see governments talking a big game but actually not taking action, then they don't see any reason why they need to actually make changes in their own lives. And that's pretty much the way for West Coasters. They're getting mixed messages from government. On the one hand, government is saying we need to do something about climate change, but actually government is not doing anything effective about climate change on pretty well any front.
If one country were to set a precedent for the world by saying we are going to open no new coal mines and we're going to gradually phase out coal over the next 20 years and we're going to put our efforts into other kinds of industry, that would be such an important international precedent that although we're a small country, you would find other countries would then find it easier to join in. And that's what we need, of course. We need a global agreement that countries will keep their coal in the ground. A global agreement about emissions isn't nearly so helpful, because if the emissions just go on a bit longer and the coal all gets burned anyway, then the same thing happens to the climate, because what you put up there stays there for thousands of years. So the only thing that's going to prevent really dangerous climate change is keeping coal and remote and unconventional oil in the ground forever.
Doesn't seem that we can do that. It's too vital a resource for our economies. And because we live with a system of capitalism and globalization, the thing accelerates. Everything that humanity uses, the growth curves go up and up and up and up and up. In a finite system, how does that stop? How does it change? You know, can you actually flatten it off? I don't think so. You know, we want to keep our economies going, and there's more people and more food and more fuel and more travel and more technology, more sales. What else can you do? And then we hit perhaps shortages of resources, and we struggle to keep it going. This is mankind, isn't it? A voracious, intelligent ape.
I think there's such a thing as a crime against future generations, and I think we've been practicing that for ever since people shoveled the first bit of coal into a steam engine. So it's been going on for 200 years. We've been extracting valuable natural resources for our own present benefit.
Maybe we need to look at using coal for the more boutique uses, the specialised uses. And if we've got a proportion of the coal industry that's sort of producing dirty electricity, maybe we should prioritise moving away from that and prioritise on the cleanest and most essential things that coal as a resource needs to be used for. And just by doing that kind of analysis, we might find that that these are the priority areas that we could focus on, and the mining industry needs to focus on these areas, and the rest of New Zealand can help it focus on these areas in some way.
Well, we've been underdogs, haven't we? We always sort of ourselves as underdogs and with everything, you know, but to a certain extent.
The opportunities are out there now for people to make real money now, money that we only dreamed of. So that, you know, the jobs are starting at about $70,000 a year up at the pool now, so, you know, the sky's the limit after that.
You worried about climate warming up?
Yeah, it's something you've got to get your head around. But, yeah, I mean, all this stuff, it's Tasmania, it polarises people, you know. You've got to get us kind of, like the lot in the middle have got to work things out.
That's probably not a question I can answer, actually. No.
Why not?
Why not? Because I don't think we should even be taking it out of the ground.
Why not?
Why not?
Yeah.
Because it is a fairly dirty product in the long run. There should be other forms of power other than coal.
It's not a smart move, is it, really? It's definitely not the way of the future. We have to be responsible for our carbon footprint here and overseas as well, in China. Yeah.
Well, it's good for our economy. Yeah, we need the jobs. Yep, absolutely. Yeah.
So West Coast Coals, they're high-quality coals and have significant value in creating the things we need to create a new economy. And that's their value. But digging them up at the quickest possible rate to turn them into consumer products to sustain the wasteful lifestyles we currently lead is actually really quite stupid. So it's not a matter of asking ourselves, should we leave those coals in the ground forever? The answer is probably no, but it's actually, what do we use it for? We should be using those coals on a sensible basis to create a new infrastructure, which means that we don't need coal anymore.
If they've already got open cast mining in other places, let them continue to expand that, but not Denniston. No. No. Denniston belongs to nature now. People have tried. Lives have been lost here trying. You can see how quickly nature takes over. I think they'd really spoil the place forever if they took the top off and had open cast mining. It would destroy this place.
It wasn't that long ago that forestry, the end of native logging, was going to be the death knell to the West Coast, and it did not prove to be that the native logging ended here, and the government put in a compensation package, and that money was divided between the regions and really made a difference. It was a government investment that really made a difference. And if we need a government investment to help after the coal mining, so be it.
Though our time is short, every minute is bought. Through the sweat shovel labor. And if it doth pass, the memories will last, buried beneath the shadows. Oh, this is my town, and this is my life. Here are the grounds that we played on and on, and a river of tears flows back through the years. The faces I knew, some now stronger.
Some years ago, there was a memorial to the women unveiled, and that to me was very fitting. Must have been really hard for the women, but leave the rest of the place, yes, as a memorial to the men. It's got a strange beauty about it, but it's also pretty forbidding in other ways.